Morning. It's the snow is actually melting, which is beautiful. I'm ready to put my shorts and sandals back on. Yeah. David, could you turn my mic down a little? Thank you. So with not that much. The mic is set for the concert yesterday, and we had a beautiful Christmas concert here, the Da Capo Band. Beautiful Christmas music, and then there was cookies and stuff downstairs. So thank you to those that were able to join us. And if you weren't able to, it was actually live streamed on Facebook, so you can view it anytime you want, even in July, for Christmas in July. We have some announcements. Jerry Dahl, if those who knew him, he passed away this past week. The funeral will be at Schumacher Kish in Onalaska tomorrow at 11 a.m. I'll be presiding over it. If you walked in on the island where Bobby and Keith are, the newsletters are on there. Am I dying again? This microphone, I tell you. It worked for Carl all day yesterday. You can hear me? I just can't hear myself. Newsletters are out there on the island. You can pick them up. We are not going to be mailing out newsletters anymore. It costs us about almost $1,200 a year to mail them all three out, and we get half of them sent back to us. Either people moved, we don't have addresses, or what have you. They're going out on the weekly updates. If you do not receive the weekly update because you don't use email or a computer, you can call the office if you're not here to pick them up. They're going to be out there for weeks. If you want them mailed to you, please call the office, and we will put you on a list when we mail out all the newsletters to the shut-ins. So if you want to be on that list, please just call Belle when she returns, and we'll get you on that list for all our mailings. We are looking at any way to save money and not waste money. And the newsletters being mailed out to people who do not receive them and or send them back, or they moved. And we have people on our list that some have already passed away, and some have moved to Madison or Florida or Virginia, and they're just not here anymore. So Christmas Eve, again, 3 o'clock and 5 o'clock. Christmas Day, we are having worship at 9:30. December 21st, we are having our Blues Christmas, the longest night, at 5:30. Please join us for that, even if you just need some time to reflect, pray, and just sing and worship. Our giving tree is over here. You can see it's ready to fall over with mittens and gloves, but you can still add on to it. And the quick trip script cards that go in your Christmas stockings, they can be purchased still, and they actually come within one day to us. So we will take orders for Christmas orders the week of Christmas Eve, up until Wednesday. You're all done with your Christmas concerts, right? Any other announcements? If you are going away for Christmas, Merry Christmas, if you're not going to be here over the next 2 weeks. If we are going to be changing your address or going down to Florida or somewhere else, please fill out our connection card. If you have not already, that way we can send you the weekly updates and keep you in the loop. I think that's enough. Oh, congratulations to Laura, who was chosen to go to Peru as a delegate for our synod. And thank you. She and I will be chatting with people about helping pay for it because I will also be going in June or July. July into August. So, congratulations to her. There was a lot of applications that went into it. So the Holy Spirit calls us together as the people of God. So let us prepare ourselves for worship. And please rise as you are able as we sing hymn number 242.
Joy for soon. shatter all hatred and blindness. In darkest night his coming shall be, when all the world is despairing, as morning light so quiet and free, so warm and gentle.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, so that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and live into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. So now let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake God forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated.
Dear Jesus, help us focus on you during this busy season. May we stay aware of the joy you bring into our lives. We want to find you in the everyday moments and come with hearts of gratitude to your manger on Christmas. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe. Your prophets spoke of a day when the desert would blossom and waters would break forth in the wilderness. Bless us as we light the candles on this wreath. Strengthen our hearts as we prepare for the coming of the Lord. May he give water to all who thirst, for he is our light and our salvation. Blessed be God forever.
Amen.
Let the light finish darkness. He shall
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia.
Worthy is Christ, the Lamb who was slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God. Power and riches.
Let us pray together. Stir up your power, Lord Christ, and come. By your merciful protection, save us from the threatening dangers of our sins and enlighten our walk in the ways of your salvation. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Today's first reading is from James chapter 5, verses 7 to 10. Be patient, therefore, beloved, until the coming of the Lord. The farmer waits for the precious crop from the earth, being patient with it until it receives the early and the late rains. You also must be patient. Strengthen your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is near. Beloved, do not grumble against one another, so that you may not be judged. See, the judge is standing at the doors. As an example of suffering and patience, beloved, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. is the Father God, your heart for now so you can sleep tonight. Go to sleep, my son. Go and chase your dreams. This world can wait for one more moment. Go and sleep in peace. I believe the glory of heaven is lying in my arms tonight. Lord, I ask that he for just this moment simply be my child. My son, baby, close your eyes. Soon enough you'll save the day, but for now, dear child of mine, oh, my Jesus, sleep tight.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When John heard in prison what the Messiah was doing, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, "Are you the one who is to come, or are we to wait for another?" Jesus answered them, "Go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive the sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor have good news brought to them. And blessed is anyone who takes no offense at me." As they went away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds about John. "What did you go out into the wilderness to look at? A reed shaken by wind? What then did you go out to see? Someone dressed in soft robes? Look, those who wear soft robes are in royal palaces. What then did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written, 'See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you.' Truly, I tell you, among those born of women, no one has arisen greater than John the Baptist. Yet the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." The Gospel of the Lord. And the peace of Christ be with you all, always. Please share a sign of God's peace. And please be seated. Somebody is wearing bells. I can hear them. I love it. And welcome back to our intentional Advent once more. And I have to say, this has been a very fruitful series for Trinity. And so I thank you for walking through this all together. And so I want, again, to share another story with you. The story is about a young man named Yaman. He is a slender 21-year-old. And Yaman is a Syrian refugee. And after fleeing Lebanon about 10 years ago, his middle-class family found themselves in Beirut, a slum with nothing to their name. Yaman learned English almost entirely on his own, and with the help of a nonprofit school for refugee children, he studied hard and passed his GED. And he began volunteering in this same nonprofit school and developed a reputation as a helpful, reliable worker. Thankfully, a donor stepped up and chose to sponsor him to go to college. And now Yaman does not own a car, so after classes, he would take a cab back to his rundown home with his family. And at some point, an interviewer asked him, "Where do you find happiness in your life?" And Yaman answered, "When we were in Syria, we were a middle class, maybe a little lower middle class, but our parents raised us to believe that we have everything we possibly need, even though we had less than other people. And they taught us to be satisfied, because happiness is what we have now. It is who we are. It is our family, our loved ones, our friends. And it's not what we may have later." He explained that his mindset has carried over into this time of crisis now. And they try to focus on what they do have, not on what they could or might or they think they should have. And a tricky part of the abundance mentality is that it's never entirely possible to exclude thoughts about the future, right? Psychologists have described two kinds of well-being that we as human beings crave: the hedonic well-being, a sense of happiness, and the eudaimonic well-being, a sense of having a purpose. And you see, like Yaman, there is joy found in well-being. And not knowing what the future may hold at times can be exciting. And accept salvation that we will have thanks due to grace through faith alone in Christ alone. And with this story, in our text today, John certainly found a purpose, a well-being, in sharing the gospel and in paving the way for the Lord with great joy. We can just imagine him, right, eating the honey and wearing the clothing and being super functional, hypertensive. Prepare the way of the Lord. Come to me. I will baptize you in with water. And yet he still had questions later on, due to his humanity, and those that we heard in our reading while he's sitting behind bars. And John's questions concern both what actions he expected of this Messiah, and will John and we stand with or against him? Because you see, these scribes, Pharisees, and other leaders who might be expected to recognize more clearly than others the nature and meaning of Jesus' ministry have already set their minds against him, against Jesus. And is this generation, which will soon kill both Jabap and Jesus, looking for the wrong signs? Or have they already, in their own way, discerned the possibility that his coming constitutes a threat to their status and their way of life? Do their investments in the status quo or their trust in their own self-righteousness make it impossible to accept the signs of God's coming, whether in judgment, redemption, or maybe even both? Friends, our buddy Jabap was eagerly looking for the one. He was looking for the one who was to come, the promised Messiah. As we often forget, his cousin, Jesus. And this Messiah would save the world from a broken down system, from all the walls that are built up. And at one time, John had been so certain that he found the one, the Messiah, that he punched the air with one pointed finger towards a carpenter from Nazareth and declared, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." But months later, as we heard, John had some human doubts that Jesus was the one, because this winnowing fork in his hand, he will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat in the barn, burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire, as we heard last week. If Jesus was the one, where is the fireworks? Where is this judgment that is supposed to happen? Why did the wicked, like King Herod, continue to prosper, while the righteous, like John himself, languished behind bars in jail? A prophet, like John, was supposed to be in a pulpit, not a prison. So as we move closer to hearing the Christmas story again this year, Jesus actually gave an answer to John's question. Jesus shared that the messenger was to, what? Go back and report to John what he hears and sees. Do you hear what I hear? The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is preached to the poor over and over again. And blessed is the man who does not fall away on account of me. You see, Jesus replied in the words of the Old Testament lesson from Isaiah 35, assigned for this week, that foretold the things the Messiah would do when he came. In fact, shortly before the events of our text today, Jesus had raised to life the widow's dead son, proving that he indeed is the promised Messiah. Now, don't you wish you could have seen some of these miracles yourself? Would that put all our doubts about Jesus to rest? But if that was the case, wouldn't Jesus himself had gone to John in prison and performed a few miracles right in front of him? Well, he didn't, did he? Instead, Jesus simply told Jabez and his disciples to describe what he was doing. In other words, Jesus dealt with John's doubts the same way he deals with ours. He points to God's word. Yes, it is through the Bible that the Holy Spirit works in our hearts to convince us of the truth of Jesus with great joy. And friends, Scripture and the Holy Spirit opens our hearts, comes to us so we can hear and see Jesus as the Messiah in such a way that he becomes the very reality of God's blessing in our lives. Our joy is found in the liberating power that Jesus, the Messiah, brings to all people, especially those that are weak, hurting, and living on the margins, much like Yamin that I talked about. Jesus brings light. Jesus brings hope. Jesus brings love. And this all comes to be joy. And now, this is not going to take away the problems of life, is it? And you see, God's solution to our problems goes a little deeper than just saying, "Don't worry, be happy." It doesn't work that way, does it? The path to true happiness, as Yamin understands, joy often winds through the desert where we experience times of challenge in our lives with bills, mortgages, our investments, our broken friendships, our marriages, death, lost loved ones, the challenges of everyday lives with tests, finals, driving hours and hours after preparing a large meal the night before to get to a Christmas meal, and talk about politics. And then, after that, shortly comes our taxes. And then next thing you know, hey, we're in Lent. Let's celebrate Easter and make another huge meal, invite 30 people over to the house and stress out, right? The everyday lives. There is pain at times. There is grief at times. There is sadness at times. There is no getting around it. There is challenge in this earthly kingdom, but also great joy, love, friendships, fellowship, and love. And we feel the joy and love because we also feel the pain. Without the pain, we would not know what love feels like, would we? So joy comes with the Holy Spirit, as God does that in us personally, physically. And what was once only a desert can suddenly bloom. And God brings us new life in abundance with great hope and joy in the heavenly kingdom. So there in the desert, we find the refreshment from God that our thirsty souls have been seeking out forever. And we find true joy, and next week, love. So if there is a place for expressing joy, it is in worship, as we worship life of God's people. And now humility, reverence, and awe, as good Lutherans, are certainly appropriate emotions for worship, right? But this doesn't exclude true joy. If we can't rejoice in church as we hear the good news of God's forgiveness in Christ and receive the very body and blood of our Lord in Holy Communion, where can we? And we know heaven will be filled with joyful singing. So why not start now? Even as we are on our way, like Yaman understood, to have joy of someone who is thirsty, finding a spring in the desert. So in Christ, we have the joy of someone blind being able to see, someone deaf able to hear, someone lame being able to jump, and someone mute being able to shout and make joyful noise. So in Christ, even when we are down in this life, we still have the joy of God's wonderful, amazing grace. So praise God. Amen.
Thank you.
As we prepare for the fullness of Christ's presence, let us pray for a world that yearns for new hope. God, you renew the church in every age. We give thanks for hymn writers and theologians, inspire teachers, writers, and musicians to delight and instruct your people. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You give us a vision of creation and harmony, when hurting and destruction will be no more. Teach us to be stewards of the earth and companions to its creatures. Restore to balance and wholeness what human greed has harmed. God, in your mercy. You defend the cause of all who are poor and oppressed. Raise up leaders who will govern with equity and serve the common good. Guide judges, lawmakers, and public officials to protect the rights of those who cannot advocate for themselves. God, in your mercy. You deliver those in need from suffering and fear. Come to the aid of any who are exploited or abused, especially children, elders, and victims of human trafficking. Provide safety and help to our neighbors without shelter, refugees, and those fleeing violence. God, in your mercy. You urge your people to welcome one another as you have welcomed us. Nurture ministries of hospitality and care in this and every congregation. We also pray for people who are homebound, hospitalized, or separated from loved ones. God, in your mercy. You embrace all who have died, trusting in your promises, and we give thanks for their faithful witness. Sustain us in hope until we are united with them in the joy of your eternal presence. God, in your mercy. God of our longing, you know our deepest needs. By your Spirit, gather our prayers and join them with the prayers of all your children. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
God feeds us with the presence of Jesus Christ. So let us now receive the offerings.
We lift our voices. We lift our hands. We lift our lives up to you. We are an offering. Lord, use our voices. Lord, use our hands. Lord, use our
please rise as you are able. Eternal God, you make the desert bloom and send springs of water to thirsty ground. Receive these simple gifts of bread and wine and money, and make us messengers of your mercy and love for all in need of your healing and justice. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You comforted your people with the promise of redemption, through whom you will also make all things new, in the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes.
You are indeed holy, almighty, and merciful God. You are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things for our salvation. It is for that reason, in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. And we ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever. Amen. Coming together as one universal church, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. All are now welcome to the table, no matter where you are in your journey of faith, for the feast is now prepared. Amen. You may be seated.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us.
Faithful God, in this meal you have remembered your mercy, bringing heaven to earth in the body and blood of Christ. As we wait for the day when all your promises will be fulfilled, sustain us and strengthen us by this holy mystery. Guide us towards your promised future, coming to birth in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. So may Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you all, now and forever. Amen. Please rise as you are able for hymn 239.
Yeah.
know, Trina, I discovered a great mystery on my way down the aisle. It's somebody's birthday today. Can we sing happy birthday to Laura? Now you may all go in peace and serve the Lord.